All right, so today I'm joined by Themba, the answer, Gorimbo. How are you doing, Themba?
I'm good, brother. How are you doing, man? How's things? How's your life? How's everybody around you?
My life is going good, man. I got good people around me. I'm going to go spend some time with my girlfriend after this. But thank you for taking the time, man.
Yeah, no problem, brother. Bless you, man. It's a blessing to be here. Thank you so much.
Yeah, man. Thank you. And so I guess I kind of want to start off with, like, the beginning of your story, bro. You have such an amazing story. And I'd like to just kind of tell my audience. So you are from Zimbabwe. Is in Africa?
Yeah. Zimbabwe is right at the bottom of Africa, next to South Africa.
Okay, and how was your life growing up over there? I believe that's like a third world country, so pretty difficult, right? No running water and things like this.
So we have these parts and places where there's running water. It's not like everything is gutters, you know. But you know, it's a very poor country, you know. We can say whatever we want to say, but like there's more poverty than anything else, but we thrive as Zimbabweans. We don't just stay at the bottom, like I always say. We try to make things and ends meet our way. We try to work hard to get to change our lives and the people around us. And yeah, man, like we probably one of the poorest countries in Africa in terms of, like, right now as it is structural and everything. But at the end of the day, you know, that does not mean that our future is dimmed, you know. We will be all right.
Sure, yeah.
Like the song just saying, yeah.
That's right. And, I mean, I guess growing up then for you, what was your perspective? Did you have a good childhood? Was it a little bit rough? How was your childhood?
So I had a good life starting out, you know, until my parents passed on, you know. When my parents passed on, then life started to become become a little bit difficult, like anybody, you know. If you ever been orphaned, you can understand how difficult it is to start, you know, to live life without your own parents, without your, you know, your own mother. My mother passed on when I was 9, and my father when I was 13.
I'm sorry to hear
so
that.
So, like, before that, life was great. But after that, life was a little bit shaky, you know. I mean, bless my cousin. He kind of, like, looked after us. But, yeah, you know, it is not the same. It is not the same. So life was a little bit rough. But with God's grace, man, that's why I am here now, you know. That's why I'm going after certain things in my life, because I know that what I have done, is whatever has happened to me in my life has led me to be here right now where I am, good or bad. You know, I'm grateful of the life that I have lived so far, the good and the bad. You know, like, people look at things, even myself before, I used to look at things and be thinking to myself, oh, why is this happening to me? Things happen for you, not to you. That's what I've realized. And let's say me being at the Diamond Fields when I was young, at 16 years old, who would ever thought that I would be at the Diamond Fields at 16, you know? If my father was alive, probably I would not have gone there to the Diamond Fields, you know? I would have probably gone the other route. But, even if, like, let's say, like, right now, me fighting, being in this fighting world, probably if my father was alive, I wouldn't be a fighter. Probably I'll be going to be a doctor or a nurse or something else, you know. You know, like in African cultures, you have to be academic, unfortunately.
Yeah, like a lawyer, right?
Doctor. Yeah, we are told that it's ingrained in us that when you grow up, you gotta be this way, that way, you know. And sometimes you gotta choose your own path in life. And I'm grateful. It's not nice that my parents are not here, that they get to see these achievements I'm doing. But I believe, like, you know, everything that has happened for a reason, and I'm here now, and I should continue to do what I was born to do, that is to fight for everything that I want and inspire the world, inspire people and change people around me and my life. You know, my life has already changed, you know. I'll be honest with you, my life has already changed. I might not have much, but my life has already changed. So, like, now the mission is to change the other people's lives that are around me. You know, people look at this and they will look at this and be like, this is so funny. This guy stays in the gym. This guy is like, when I say my life has changed, it has changed in a way that it's unheard of. Like, being here in Miami for me, like, bro, I'm in Miami. Mm-hmm. from Piquita to Miami. It's crazy. It's crazy. I actually grew up, I never heard of this city growing up because it's like, we just know America, United States. And there's like very, very, very few, you know. And everybody that could ever come here, that we believe that would come here, they are all very like educated doctors, nurses. I mean, a nurse is not even. Doctors, pilots, and all that. So like, it was believed growing up that if you want to make it to go to a place like United States, United Kingdom, anywhere around the world, you have to be very educated. But you know, I have changed the norm and I'm here now.
Yeah.
And that's why I'm so grateful. Like I've made it in life.
Right. Coming from where you
I've
came
made
from.
It in life. Coming from where I come from, whatever happens in my life, whether it's gonna be good, whether it's gonna be bad, it's a cherry on top of what has already, you know, of this success story I have already had, bro. Like my story is already a success as it is. But you know what? I want more.
Yeah.
You know what? I want to change the people around me's lives too. So to do that, I have to keep motivated. I have to keep working.
Gotcha. And I do want to talk about that because you've already done a lot to help people. And I think it may have backfired on you a little bit, but we'll get into that in a second here. But when your parents were around, were you able to, did you have a different dream as far as your career? You said that there might be lawyers, doctors. Was that something you were looking at doing or were you not sure?
I'll be honest with you, right?
Yeah.
Growing up, I was a good soccer player. I used to play. I wanted to be a soccer player, but my father would say, no, if you want to be a soccer player, you would support my dream of being a soccer player. You buy me boots, you buy me things that I needed for playing soccer, right? You support me everything. But he says, no, you must be a doctor and a soccer player. Mm. So there was a, growing up, there's this doctor that was a soccer player in Zimbabwe. He was named Dr. Kumalo. So he would say, no, I want you to be like Dr. Kumalo. He's a doctor, but he's a soccer player and he's very good. So like that's how I grew up, you know. But deep within, I knew I was made different. I was made different. Deep within, I always knew that I was very good at school. I was very good academically, you know. But at the end of the day, inside me, when the teacher would ask, "What do you wanna be when you grow up?" I would say, "My father said you must be a doctor." You know, I never said I want to be a doctor.
I see.
I always knew that one day I'll be something. For some reason, I always knew one day I'll be something bigger than myself. And I'm not even yet, but I just know that I'm born different. I am different. I'm misunderstood a lot. But when this story is come to an end and it's done, people will come back and look at it and be like, okay, no wonder why he was different.
Yeah.
You know, I know this. I know this for a fact that when my story is done, people will come back and look at it and be like, okay, this was the different. It was the black sheep of the family, you know. I'm very misunderstood and I'm grateful for that because, you know, like I have tried to go out of my way to try to fit in. I cannot fit in any area, whether you like it or not. You know, I feel like I'm a natural born leader.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't do well with just being mediocre. I want to achieve greatness.
Yeah. Isn't that kind of crazy though? How like being a black sheep or almost being outcasted can just make you become a lot better than, you know, most people. I mean, the stuff you've been through, being in the diamond fields, growing up in Africa, coming here. It's like, and then you said your family or like friends kind of abandoned you after a loss, which we will talk about, but it's crazy. Like the tough things in life, it depends how you look at it. If you look at it and let it destroy you, it will. But if you look at that and say that, hey man, I'm chosen in a sense. And you know, there's a greater destiny for me because of these things I've been through and I have a story to tell. I could see how that motivates you, the way you kind of view the things that have happened in your life.
So look, like, I was always different, like I said to you, growing up. Even when I was at the Diamond Fields, you know, I was 16 years old. I would always outshine the people that were there. Like, in the Diamond Fields, they were grown up, people that were in their 30s. They would be scared to get into the Diamond Fields to go dig the diamonds while there's guns and stuff like that. Yes, and I understand that. But I would always say, no, fuck it, I'm going in. Mm-hmm. You know, if you go and ask everybody there back home in my village, they'll tell you this guy was always different. He always gone for things. I've always gone for things. And it takes a long time to realize that you are different to everybody, and you should not try to fit in. And it's like people would say, no, you got to be humble. You got to be this. You got to be that. Yeah, I'm very humble. Trust me. If you get to know me as a person, if you get to meet me as a person, I'm very humble. And that word humble as well, I feel like it's misused in a way, because sometimes people want you to downplay what you have done or downplay what you can do just for them to feel comfortable. So like for me, I am who I am. I'm not humble. I'm not whatever. I am who I am. That's the best way I can put it. You know, I am who I am. Like me, hate me. It is what it is. It's life. And I know I'm different. I'm different to most. Being in the UFC, this me just being in the UFC, man, I was chosen by God to be here. You know, that's how I say it. And I have visions day and night of things that could and would happen in the future. And it's not easy to be in that position where like when I say visions, basically like sometimes I have things shown to me and that other people can't see. You know, it's not nice. Sometimes it scares me, I'll be honest. But it's life, man. I have to accept this gift that I was given, because I've tried to run away from it for so long. I have to just accept it. You know what I'm saying? Like, yeah, I have to accept that, you know, I'm not the same. I'm not the same. It's just different.
Yeah. And what do you see sometimes? You said that you kind of see things. I guess what do you see?
Yeah, man, it's tough. It's tough to explain, if I have to be honest, man. It's okay.
Yeah. Okay.
It's different. Yeah, man.
We can move on. As far as, like, I'm curious, though, did you finish grade school and stuff like that?
Yeah, I went to high school. I passed my grade 7 and I did very well, and I passed my
high school.
I passed my high school and I was going to A level. It's in the advanced level in Zimbabwe. But then I just thought, like, to myself, this is not for me. I told my cousin. My cousin wanted me to do that so much, and I just told him, this is not for me. I don't want to do this. I don't want to go to school anymore. I want to go to South Africa. And he says to me, are you crazy? What are you going to do in South Africa? Then I said to him, I'll figure it out.
Mm-hmm.
School was not for me.
Wasn't for you.
Honestly, like, it was not the path that I was born to do. And you can tell, even when I go to South Africa, I worked as a gardener, I worked as a painter, security guard, all kinds of jobs that you can, the low income jobs that you can find, you know, like, I could, you know, we would stay in one room with six of my other cousins. We stayed in one room for like 2 years or so. Mm-hmm. But you would never see me one day think that this was the best life for me. You would never see me one day thinking to myself that I was going to stay there. I always, even those days when I got to South Africa, there was always one song I used to play from Akon. It says, I always knew one day I would be a star. I always, you know, like, I always knew something big was going to come in my life. Mm-hmm. I didn't know exactly what it was. I thought maybe I was going to be a rapper, musician, whatsoever. That's what I thought. But I just knew something. I'm not born for just being average and normal. You know? Mm-hmm. It's life, unfortunately.
So you could rap?
But
or
I. No, I try to sing. I try to go to music school to try and do that too. You know, I can't rap for sure.
Okay.
But I try to do. I tried to do those things so that, you know, like, I just knew something. I have to do something. I have to try something. I'm going to be successful with something. Then eventually I watched the movie Never Back Down. Once I was at the back of the Bucky, a Bucky is called, you know how it's a Bucky. I don't know what you guys call it here in America.
Maybe a bus?
A Bucky there in South Africa.
Or
no, a truck.
A truck.
I was in the back of a mini champ.
Okay.
My boss mini champ. Then I saw a poster saying for a jiu-jitsu school that was in the area that we were working in. Then I took the number while we were on the robot, called them, then started doing jiu-jitsu. Then I ended up doing MMA at a gym next to it. So, like, it's, yeah, like I said to you, man, God always put for me things in my life that I want. Mm-hmm. I mean, not that I want. God put for me things that I need. And, like, from watching the movie Never Back Down, from thinking, I'm going to do this, I want to fight, then from me standing at the, like, being at the back of the barkey or truck, whatever you call it here in America, right?
Yeah.
To see that poster and say, that poster said jiu-jitsu, martial arts, whatever. Then I took that number and I called them and said jiu-jitsu. Then I went on to do MMA. You cannot say that this is coincidence in life. I know this. I'm not... There's no coincidence in life.
Yeah.
I'll achieve something big. You will see.
That's right.
It's life. Whether I'm going to come up, down, I will achieve something big in my life that nobody else has ever done in their lives. And my story shall be remembered even long after I'm gone.
Okay. And I just want to share a story with you, man, because you shared that with me. So, like, because you said there's no coincidence in life, and... funny story. So the way I got into, like, martial arts was I wrestled in high school, but I was looking for something more after I graduated. And then I joined some gym, and it was actually, like, about to close down, but a jiu-jitsu instructor purchased it. And then, like, it started, like, a whole gi jiu-jitsu journey for me. And before that, if he didn't purchase it, it was just kind of like an average gym. But, like, it's just crazy. Like, and then that is kind of why I'm speaking to you today, you know, because I kind of got into martial arts and I liked it. I wanted to watch fighters and talk to fighters and stuff. So there really is no coincidence in life, man. Like, I think a lot of things happen for a reason.
There is no coincidence in life. Yeah. If you think that, I used to think like that, and God has shown me otherwise, you know. Like, whether it's bad or good, there is no coincidence in life. Everything happens when it needs to happen, not when we want it to happen. And God put these things in our lives when He wants us to have those things.
Right.
Yeah, I'm just grateful. I'm very, very happy and grateful that I can be able to share my story. I sometimes don't want to share my story.
Mm-hmm.
Because sometimes it has come back and bite me, and sometimes it has come back and was used against me. Like, I would share some people. Like, I would share stories with people, you know, like, as, like, close associates, people around me, and I'll share with them a story. And then they will use it against me, or use it to, you know, like, as a hold on you, you know. Like, once I shared one thing, you know, like, there was times just before I got signed to the UFC. Like, I'll be honest with you, like, I was in a very dark place in my, as a person, you know, like, things were going south. Family-wise, and things were going south, career-wise, you know. People don't even know this. That's why, like, people don't understand why I have so much love for my manager.
Jason House,
because, you know what? There were times I wanted to actually, like, kill myself as a person, you know. And I remember this. I bought a gun, literally, and I was just like, I'm gonna kill myself, you know, because one, we're in talks for Contender Series, and I was promised I'm gonna be on Contender Series, and my contract for Contender Series was not coming, and I had this third degree burn. You see my hand, my arm over there.
Yeah.
I had a third degree burn on my arm. So I had a third degree burn on my arm, and then things were just not good, man. Like. And Jason House is one of the only people that told me, hey, brother, this is what he told me. He's like, brother, don't do that. If you do that, the world will never know, and you will never know, and we will never know what you can do, you know. And that just speaks volumes as a person. So, like, I've shared this story maybe with other people that were close to me then. I've shared my troubles with some people, and they felt like me sharing my trouble with them, it was almost like a hold for them to say, oh, we were there for you when you were down. So you cannot be, you know what I'm saying? You know, whereas, like, I just wanted someone to talk to, maybe, you know, that time and moment. And I shared with them my story, and they felt like, okay, cool. like, I don't know how to say it, superiority complex, or right? whatever we can call it, in a way where you tell someone something, even if they're not going to help you, like, this person didn't help me nothing with anything, but felt like, okay, cool, just because you shared that story with me, I'm entitled to everything that you do in your life, you know. So I was, I always try to avoid those things now where I share a lot with people,
yeah.
Especially my circle. Like, that's why I say, like, when I'm here in Miami, I don't make friends. Obviously there's great people, you know. I can make associates, but I don't want to replace negative with negative. So when I'm here in Miami, I'm down. Like, as you can see where I am right now, I'm all by myself.
Yeah.
I train, I'm washing my clothes, I go back, I take my clothes, I go back to the gym, I chill in the gym. Because, you know, like, the vision, the dream that I want is very near. I can feel this. It's very, very near. And if I get one more negative situation in my life, I'll be destroying myself and the story that I'm telling. So I would rather suffer being myself alone, and, like, you know, I will vent when I need to vent. I will say when I need to say with certain people. I can talk to you like we're doing now, yeah. You know. But yeah, I try not to share it a lot.
Okay. I think what you're saying is they tried to manipulate you. What happened is you said, yeah, like, hey, you know, I was going through something. And then they used, like, hearing that as a way to get something from you. Once you, it sounds like you probably achieved a little bit of success. All of a sudden, it's like, hey, why aren't you there for me? But they're trying to manipulate the situation, you know, just because you achieve success doesn't mean they get a part of it, you know, just because you share a story.
It's not nice, you know, like one of the guys, like my old coaches, actually. And it's not nice to have these things with people, and I don't like to have these certain things with people. But, you know, like I said to you, I don't want to be told what to do in my life. You know, whether you are a billionaire or a millionaire or you're a thousand guy, you know, I don't want to be told what to do. And he called me and he's telling me, why did I speak like this on the press conference? I said to him, anything that I said on that press conference is a lie, you know. And one, this guy was not even there when I said some of my coaches left me. Mm-hmm. And even the guys that left me, at the hotel, whatever, they do not even have a problem. One of the guys, I still speak to him all the time, is my friend, Nomeva. I tell him, hey, bro, if you see a post I posted recently with a guy I was teaching how to eat, he was one of them. But I spoke to him and I said to him, brother, what happened that night was not cool. He's like, oh, I just wanted to go out with the other guys. The other guys wanted to go out. And I said, it's okay. But, you know, can you imagine how you would feel, you know, mm-hmm. if it was you? And yeah, and it is like that in its life, you know. And there's this guy, he was not even part of the team that came with me to Las Vegas for this first fight. And he had the audacity to call me and try to say, and he even threatened me with all kinds of stuff. And I was not happy with that, you know.
Yeah.
It's not nice. Especially, like, for me, I feel like I could have helped him even with certain things in life. But, you know, like, people want to control other people, and I'm not that guy. I don't like to be told what to do. I want to say what I want, and when I say and vent, people don't know how much pain I went through leading up to that fight. So when I go to that press conference and I say what I said, I was speaking from my heart. I didn't speak from anything. I spoke from my heart on exactly what I felt in that moment in time. Because, you know what, if you're not organic, if you're not authentic, this sport, you're not gonna make it. And look at it now. I have made so many waves just by being by being authentic, you know. Like, I spoke about my situation, the people, the life. Like, even my brother, like, I spoke even about my brother, but my brother understands. He knows me for a very long time. Me and my brother, we still talk. I even gave him my gym. Now I left the gym in his hands and the other guy's hands, you know. But not that I'm proud of what he did in the past, but now it's a lesson learned. And if you want to take these things in life as lessons, you can only grow from those things, you know, like, whether it's negative or positive, you can only grow. But if you want to criticize, make it, like, about yourself most of the time, it's life, my brother. I don't know.
No, I hear you, man. And, I mean, like you say, that's why you kind of spend time by yourself, it sounds like. I also spend a lot of time kind of by myself, and when I hang out with people, I kind of feel my energy getting like pulled in all directions. So I prefer to kind of be in tune with my thoughts. You said that you feel like you're close to achieving things, and I think it's best to kind of be in tune with that and just keep manifesting what you want to accomplish. But
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. That's what you want to do as a person. Like for me, I'm just happy to just be here. I'm just happy trying to... Yeah, you have to be, firstly, like, you have to be happy with being you and being around yourself before you try to be around everything else, you know. I'm happy being around myself now. I'm learning that I can achieve so much by just being around me. I don't have to have a bunch of things and people around me telling me that, telling me this, telling me that, to achieve what I want to achieve, you know.
Yeah.
I reach out to certain people. I have got people that I can trust with advices, and God puts these people in my life and removes people in my life, and I appreciate that. What I need, He gives me. So with time, everything will fall the way it needs to fall, you know.
Yeah. And I'd like to just go back a little bit, because you said that you moved to South Africa. And did you move to South Africa knowing that you were going to go start hunting for diamonds, basically, or what was the whole that little process about in your life?
No, the diamonds, I did them in Zimbabwe, not in South Africa.
Oh, in Zimbabwe.
So I was, yeah, at the Marange diamonds in Zimbabwe. So I left school. I said to my cousin, I'm not going to go to school. So I went to the diamonds. When I came back from the diamonds, he wanted me back to go back to school again. I said to him, I'm not going to go to school. Sorry, man. I have enough money. If you want, when you come in December, in January, we can go back. I can go with you to South Africa. And we did. And I got deported the first time. Mm. Like, you know, I got deported the very day that I arrived in South Africa. You know, I was arrested by the police because I didn't have a passport, no visa, no nothing.
How did you get there?
Not even an ID. No, Zimbabwe and South Africa is next to each other. I didn't even have an ID. I only managed to take my ID when I was already old, you know. So, like, I went to South Africa without anything and I got deported. But you know what? Like, this is how I said to you, like, there's no coincidence in life. I never gave up. So the day that they threw me on the Zimbabwe side, they put us on the Zimbabwe side. The day I was deported, and they put us on the Zimbabwe side and said, go back to your homes. I said to them, I was from that area, and I just lied to them. Then that same night, around 4 o'clock, they deported me. That same night, 7 p.m., I was already in South Africa again, and the second time I succeeded. I went all the way and lived on the streets in Johannesburg, then made contacts with my cousins, then eventually made it to Cape Town, you know.
Okay.
But there's no coincidence in life, like, not giving up. You don't just start by now doing that now. You know, like, I didn't give up. If I wanted, like, my cousin who was deported with me and his other few cousins, they went back home to safety. Mm-hmm. I was like, I'm not going home. You guys can go. I'm not going away. I'm going back in there. And they thought, hey, I was turning 17. I was 17, you know, like, I was 17. And they thought to myself, they thought, you must be crazy. But I was like, they were like older than me, but I was like, I'm gonna do this, whether you guys like it or not, I'm going back. And the second time I succeeded, they thought I would get killed or whatever.
Yeah.
But,
and
So
just because people may not know the full thing, right before that, you were like attacked by dogs because hunting diamonds is illegal. And then you still made a decision to sneak back into South Africa a second time. You're a crazy guy.
Yeah, I was. So if you see my whole body, there's like dog marks.
Yeah.
I was attacked by dogs, and the dogs. I almost died, man. I almost died. So like, that was the actual. Yeah, like, you know, like the dogs beat me. I had 5 German Shepherds biting me. I still remember this, and I lost a lot of blood. And on top of that, when these dogs attacked me, then the police said, all right, cool, now you must run. Then I heard the police whispering to each other. It was a group of like 20 people beaten by the dogs. Then I heard the police whispering, saying, release one dog for them, you know, to chase them when they release us again. Then I ran my own direction, the different direction, and my cousin actually was caught by the dogs again the second time and was beaten again.
Damn.
But I passed out after that because I ran so fast and so hard. I didn't have clothes at all. I was naked. I ran out naked from that place because the dogs beat everything.
They just ripped it, off all your
They ripped off everything. So I ran naked for like 2-3 kilometers. with all the blood loss, when I get to the fire guard, when I go to the fire guard, I passed out. I saw white, like, in my face. Passed out, woke up the following morning, and woke up to chaos again. Like, the police and the soldiers were in there and chasing all the people out of the fields. The policeman saw me and he's like, hey, there's a person that is here. They thought I was dead or whatever. Then I was like, oh shit, I'm up. Then they said to me, hey, listen here, you need to get out of here. There's an operation that is happening, you need to get out of here. And I couldn't walk properly. I had so many dog marks, like the other dog tried to rip my tendons here, right behind the knees. So yeah, I walked my way out, and the week later I was back again in the diamond fields with some of the wounds, like the one behind my knee, the tendon that was where the dog was trying to rip, it was not healed. It took like months to heal. I was still not healed, and I went back to the diamond field, and guess what? I made a lot of money. That's when I found the 12 carat diamond.
Damn.
And I made a lot of money for that. I made a lot of money with that. So like, when you don't give up in life,
yeah,
good things will always come. Yeah.
I would have definitely thought you never went back to the diamond fields after that, but that just solidifies that you were a crazy guy. But
It's like, okay, cool. You learn a lesson, right? Yeah. Like, the dogs beat me because I was complacent. I was getting too complacent in the diamond field. I was thinking I was the shit. So, like, literally, I was with this policeman and my cousin, and I was underground. I was the one who was underground, and my cousin was just behind me, and the policeman was waiting upstairs. We trusted someone so much, and we thought this policeman would protect us if anything happens. And then they are... like, they've got levels in policemen department in Zimbabwe. Then their bosses came, and then they ran. Mm. These policemen ran. They left us underground. So we learned a lesson that, hey, don't rely, don't trust nobody. Don't rely on people. So I learned that lesson, and I was like, okay, cool. The next time I'm going there, I'm not going to rely on policemen to help me. I'm going to dig by myself, you know.
Yeah.
So it was just God teaching me the lessons, and I am learning those lessons. Every single day.
Okay. And so when you, like, what is the process of hunting the diamonds? I'm so curious. Like, do you just go out there with a shovel, or could you explain how you locate there with these things?
No, so in the Marange diamonds, when the diamond fields we discovered that there were plenty of diamonds, man. There were plenty. Like, there was one time I was being chased by the police. Whilst I was running, I picked up a diamond while I was running. That's how much diamonds were there in the Marange diamonds in the beginning, you know. So, like, we just go in there, dig. Sometimes you go very deep, sometimes you don't go deep, you know, like...
Deep into the forest? Depends, like,
it's in the forest. Okay. And it's a protected area. We were not supposed to be there.
I see.
But we did that because, you know, otherwise it's the natural resource. In our country, like, it was like less than 60 minutes from where I were, from my village. So it was like the easiest thing to do. It's like, you, some people didn't go, but because it was scary to go there. I've seen people die in front of me. I've seen a guy getting shot, a bullet right through his head in front of me.
Oh my God.
I've had bullets boom, 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 in my head, you know, in my ears. I've seen crazy stuff when I was at the diamond.
So they shoot people too out there, like.
Yeah, live bullets. They were shooting people with live bullets.
Wow.
Yeah. Because also, like, when you are there, you're basically an animal too.
Mm.
You know, like, you have to turn into an animal. If you are not an animal, you're gonna, one, you are dealing with the police that are trying to protect this place, and they also are shooting at you and the army. And then you are dealing with the criminals that are trying to, the lazy ones that don't want to go into the diamond for that, wait outside just for you to go in. When you come out, when you get something, they want to take it from you. So you got to kind of like develop this mindset where you are an animal.
Mm.
Like, you have your back, you know, you have your back. And you'd kill if you have to.
Yeah.
But luckily I never got to do that. But I was prepared to do that, you know, to protect my own, to protect myself, to protect my diamond. So, like, you will have to do that, and you have to turn into an animal. And, like, those things that you see in the diamond movies, if you watch the Blood Diamond,
mm-hmm.
the movie, So basically, similar to that, where like someone is like the boss, whatever, and everybody has to bow down to them. But within that, with the pain that you go through, you actually turn into an animal. And yeah, man, I turned into an animal when I was there. I was not a friendly man.
Wow.
I was a lucky man getting diamonds all the time, but I was not very friendly. I didn't do any harm to anybody, but I always let people know that I'm not your friend.
Wow.
Even the people that they come from the same village with, I would always show them that I'm the boss of my syndicate. It was only two of us, me and my cousin, in my syndicate. And people would want to, these adults, older guys wanting to just get into our syndicate without authority and just force themselves into our thing. And I'll say, hey, man, I'm the lucky guy. My cousin is pure and he's also lucky. I don't want to just get people with bad energy into my team, you know. And people want to force themselves into your team sometimes, and I had to stand my gun and be like, hey, bro, I'm going to hit you with this metal thing if you play with me.
Yeah.
And you're going to show them with your eyes wide open with a scary face, you know. It's life.
Yeah, that's crazy. Did you ever have someone try to, like, rob you as you walked out of the fields?
Yeah, the day I got the 12-carat diamond, someone wanted to take it away from me. What's funny, my cousin's sister was dating this guy, and I trusted him, and I thought to myself, okay, cool, let me go to him and say to him, I got this diamond, can you get me a good buyer? Then when he realized the diamond that I had, he wanted to steal it from me, and yeah, I just managed to get away from him like this.
Okay.
Yeah.
Luckily, huh?
Yes, yes.
Okay, and...
Yeah. It could have ended up so very... We had to run for long. We ran like 20 kilometers, me and my other cousin. We ran for like 20 kilometers away from these guys.
Dang.
They were fat, so they got a little bit tired.
I see.
They didn't want to show it obvious that they were trying to rob us, but I could sense that they're trying to take this diamond away from
me. Yeah, like, oh, can I see? Yeah, I know what you're saying. Acting
like Yeah.
I've seen that before.
Yeah.
So how do you sell these diamonds as well? Is there a, like, the guy, like you said, in the Blood Diamond movie, is there a boss you can go sell these to? Or how do you get cash for them?
No, they were buyers. There were people buying the diamonds, man. And what's funny, like the US dollars, they were there all the time.
Dang.
We would sell the diamonds with US dollars. Like, yeah, it's crazy. I don't know where this money was coming from, but they were like brand new US dollars where you don't even have to... In some... I'm going to have to move inside. It's a little bit rainy here now. But in some cases... You don't have to count the money. You count the number. That's how crazy it was. Like, you know, the money was so new that at some point you don't have to count the... You don't have to count the money. You just count the numbers from number one to number 50.
Damn.
You know?
Yeah.
Type of stuff like that.
The serial number.
Yeah.
The brand new bills.
Yeah, so they were brand new bills that... You only had to count the numbers with their serial number. So I don't know where this money was coming from because what we were doing was illegal.
Yeah.
So I think somebody was getting involved, you know.
Giving somebody the money to then go out with like five people to buy diamonds from you.
Yeah, from us. Yeah, from everybody that was there, you know.
Okay.
It was cool and crazy.
Where are you heading now? You head to your room?
No. I'm not at the gym that I stay at. I'm at a different gym. I'm at the UFC Fit.
Okay. Gotcha. Well, I got a few more for you, man, and then we can kind of wrap it up. Are you doing okay on time for now?
Yeah. I just have to go in now in like 10 minutes.
Okay, for sure.
Less than 10 minutes,
So like 10, or what is it over there? 1:40? We'll wrap this up in about 10 minutes.
All right, cool.
Okay, brother. So, you know, I heard that you've done a lot of nice things in Africa as well. I heard that you have, like, opened up a gym and, like, you auctioned off your fight shorts and stuff like that. Is that something you plan on doing more of? Like, you built a well, right?
Yeah,
after
helping.
Your fight?
Yeah, man. After the fight, I managed to sell my fight kit and raise funds, and I used that money to build a bush pump, you know, in my village. And bro, this bush pump, that's why I say I've made it, because who would ever thought that I would be able to bring a fresh water, clean water to my village? So like,
yeah,
it's like a dream come true for me, you know. And a gym that I owned a gym in South Africa, like now I've given it away, like I told you. Like I had this gym for like 5 years. I was helped by somebody to open it up, and I've helped everybody to just kind of like get a place to train where they were free and stuff like that. But, you know, with that comes with a lot. When you have too many people and too many energies and too many different agendas in life, things kind of like go south. But I bless people, you know, I bless people. I wish nothing but the best for everybody. It's hard to say. Sometimes you feel angry as a person and you got to accept those feelings when they come. But I always try to say, hey, God, I don't want to feel like this. You know, like when I feel angry for certain individuals and certain people, you just kind of like, you don't want to feel that way. But at the end of the day, I want to continue helping. You know, helping people, helping things, helping makes me happy. Do you understand me? I hope you can get to understand this. Like for me, if I help somebody, it's for my own selfish reasons. Why? Because a lot of people don't want to accept. But for me, when I help, I feel good. And when I feel good, I'm happy. And then when I'm happy, best believe, my friend, I'm a very dangerous fighter. Mm-hmm. You understand? Like when I'm happy, I'm dangerous. So I have to always try to do things that make me feel happy inside. If I have too many emotions, I'm angry, I'm like this, I'm like that, then, you know, that's not me. I'm out of my character. But when I'm happy, helping and doing that, oh, my brother, I'm a very dangerous person. So I will continue to do this. I'll do more even. But now I have to just kind of like less, with lesser expectations of people, because people are different. We are all different. I have to do that also with, I have to do that with a clearer head, where I kind of like understand where people are coming from. Because some people, when they need something, they will act nice. When they don't need it, they will be very horrible. Like now, I'm a bad guy. I'm a bad guy in South Africa right now. Why? Because I've left some people that I felt like they were not doing me justice in my own life as a person. And I have, can you see me?
Yeah, yeah. I think you're, yeah, so you're back on.
I've left some things and people, and forget very quickly, man. People forget very quickly, my friend. Now all of a sudden I'm a bad guy. Now all of a sudden, you know, people forget very quickly. But at the end of the day, people are people, right? People forget very quickly.
Human
and we
nature,
should understand,
yes.
Like, Yeah. It's a human nature where people forget like things very, very fast. Everything that you've done, there for them that is good, can be forgotten in a blink of an eye. You know what I'm saying?
Go ahead.
Sorry, I was saying to you like people are people, and people will forget things like this. And anything that you do, even if you do 1,000 years of good, and one day you just wake up a different person, people will run away with that one thing. You know, they don't want to acknowledge what you have done, because sometimes it makes them feel less of human beings or a person, you know, of who they want the world to portray them to be. So you gotta be very careful with people. People change very quickly. So for me, I've learned that lesson, and I'm grateful of that lesson. And I'll just do more of what I've always been doing, but with lesser expectations of people as a person. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, that makes sense. It's very true. You know, you got to watch out for those people who always ask you for something and you say yes. And then the one time you say no, all of a sudden there's a problem. Those are the people you really got to watch out for. But
I also saw that
Colby Covington. Right.
You
that's
put
what you're
it
trying
very
to say
right now. Yeah, like you gotta watch out for the people that you always say yes to, and then one time you say no to them, then it's a problem. And one time you just try to look out for yourself, there is a problem. So those are the people that, you know, I've always dealt with, and I can see that, you know, like some of these kids, you know, like I'm like, bro, But you know, it's long story short. Let's leave it. We can't dwell on it.
Nah. And one positive thing is you got a teammate over there, somebody who's looking out for you. When you were down, Colby Covington, a lot of people have him misunderstood, but he showed you love, huh? Especially in a tough time in your life when you were training for your fight.
People don't even understand, like, for me, whether it's a big help or a small help, this is how I always like things to be. Mm-hmm. I'm a person that is very grateful. And I think this is the biggest downfall for me as a person, because I'm very grateful. Because I'm very grateful of people, of things and people, right? People don't understand this. Probably Kobe, like, if I have to be honest, he brought me food a couple of times, right? People don't understand that. But I'm so grateful, because you know what? Small help, big help, for me, it means a lot. You understand? So people don't get this. They think, oh, small help, big help means a lot to me. And I always try to put this on people too. And it's not nice sometimes because I try to see myself in others. Because, like, if I do something for you that is small or big, please try to be grateful. Please try to be appreciative. And for me, saying that on the press conference, I didn't have to say that. You know what I'm saying? I didn't have to talk about Kobe on my press conference. But I did. Why? Because he helped me. Do you get what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm. Big or little, he gave you. He came there, he helped you. But I'm curious, man. What, like, just so people can really know what kind of guy he is, like, what happened? He just showed up to the gym with some food for you, and he's like, "Hey, Themba, like,
yeah." He's like, "Yeah, Themba, there's food at the front desk. I brought for you some food." And I'm like, "Okay, thank you, bro." And it means a lot to me, whether it's small or big. People, and you know, like, the person that he is, and the person that people see, it's a very different story. That guy is a good guy, you know. And we are, like, I don't want to say it, because it's contradicting sometimes. We are all bad people. Like John Jones say, trying to be good. Some try to be good more than others. That's how I see it. And
I agree with
we are all bad people. And yes, we are all bad people. Some trying to do good more than others. Yeah.
Yeah.
That's how I see it.
Okay, so I guess that's what you're saying, right? Like people kind of misunderstand Colby, but we're all kind of bad a little bit, but some people do like glorify the good deeds they do, but he's not over here saying, oh, I'm giving Themba food, and you know, he's not out there doing
he's a good person as a person, and people don't, you see the problem is you have to meet people in person, have the one-on-one with them, and then you kind of like judge them from that. For me, before you meet me, please don't judge me. Until you meet me, don't hear from others, because you know what, maybe that person that you are hearing from is ask for something, and maybe I genuinely didn't have it. Maybe I genuinely said no. Maybe I genuinely couldn't afford to help them or whatsoever, and they took it personal. So don't always take what you hear from others. Try to get information firsthand. That's how I see it.
Right.
Get to meet the person, spend some time with them, then you can judge.
Yeah, I've been wrong before. Some people I didn't like in the past, I meet them, I'm like, damn, he's a good guy. Last thing I have for you, Themba, what do you want next? You looking to fight in a few months, couple months? What's next for your fighting career?
For me, I don't know when I'm fighting, honestly. I'm just here in America to get better, to train and get better, fit, stronger and better. Can I say when I'm fighting? We've had discussions with my manager, and he says to me, it's going to be October. Who am I fighting?
Well, maybe
I don't
Abu Dhabi.
Know, man. I would fight there. I wouldn't want to fight there, honestly. I want to fight in the United States. It's nicer here. If I have to fight there, it's okay. You know, it's not like the world has come to an end. There's been times where life was worse. So, like, having to fly to Abu Dhabi and fight there, I'll do that. But I want to fight in the United States. That's the place that go where you are celebrated. Do things in the places that you are celebrated. I'm celebrated in America. People love me here. As a person, I'm loved here in America. And my personality suits better here. You know, there's more freedom speech, and yeah, I love it here.
Yeah, a lot of people have seen that video I posted about your bedroom, and I think that's why they love you, is because we are so privileged, you know, as Americans, and to see someone who like makes so much out of so little, it's really inspiring to, I think, everyone who comes from this country, at least.
Yeah, like I just posted that video, you know, to just show people that the journey is not always, like, you know, people will think that, yeah, if I'm in South Africa, I can live very good. I've got a nice place in South Africa where I live. But when I'm here, you have to sacrifice good for the better, for the future, you know. Like, I'm here staying on the couch. I've got my own bedroom in South Africa. So, like, I'm downtown, you know. So you kind of, like, have to understand that you need to tell a story and inspire people that, hey, you have to sacrifice. Not everything that you do should always be nice, should always be the best and whatsoever. You know, like I'm living in Miami on a couch. A lot of people wouldn't do that, especially like people like the comfort zone. And best believe me, I also love the comfort zone. I would love to be waking up in my bedroom in South Africa. I would love to be waking up in my own house. But knowing that sacrificing what I'm sacrificing will only bring better in the future. You know, like I have had a sponsor now that wants to pay me to stay at their hotel. Guess what did I say to the sponsor? No, man, I don't want to stay in a hotel. You know, if I wanted comfort, I would do that. But right now, I don't want to stay in a hotel. I'm happy on the couch. Please leave me on the couch. Then you say, cool, I respect that. I'll send you the meals, rather. You know?
Yeah. Respect, bro. Respect. You're a good man, Themba. I love your whole story and everything, man. So thank you for sharing it with me. And I just want to say, lastly, I'll be looking out for your hangout session with The Rock, man. Hopefully you guys can get a documentary or a movie going about your life. That would be sick.
Yeah, we're going to do that. Me and Dwayne Johnson, we are going to... Yeah, it's going to be big. When I meet him, it's going to be big. Yeah. It's going to be huge. We are going to do something good. And yeah, man, stay tuned. But other than that, you know, like, just follow my story. It's going to be amazing, this story. That's why I try to document almost everything that I do every single day.
Yeah.
Because when I come back to look at it, this story is going to be a blockbuster. I can tell you this. My story,
this
is going to...
Yes, sir. And also, that's why I was so asking you all these little questions about your life and your upbringing and stuff, because I want to be able to document, you know, your life story for the fans to kind of come here and hear all about your life. So I feel like this is a good interview where they can learn all about your life, where you talked about like your childhood all the way up till now. So it's pretty cool.
Yeah, man. Bless you, my brother. Thank you so much. I just
all right.
Need to
bless you, my brother.
Oh, bless
yes, sir.
You.
Have a good rest of your day, man. And thank you for the time.